One of the first things you learn in school after knowing your basic arithmetic operations is the order of operations. On one hand, this makes perfect sense. We have a bunch of operations and we have to know which one to do first. On the other hand, this also seems silly. We read from left to right, so why don't we just evaluate everything from left to right as well? Why do we have to come up with a convoluted set of rules for this? Where does it come from? What if we chose not to follow these rules? In this video, we will explore multiple reasons in defense of it. However, hopefully the reasoning will be general enough that you'll understand when and why other order schemes are also valid. In addition, by understanding the motivation, you might no longer need to rely on imperfect mnemonics to remember the correct order. You'll just know it. Before we even begin talking about the order of operations itself, we need to first understand that the order of operations is a matter of convention, not mathematical truth. For any value or expression you want to communicate, you have to communicate how that value or expression is obtained. It has to be interpreted by others. The order of operations doesn't matter, as long as all communicating parties agree to some order, in the same way that communicating parties should agree on the definitions of words before they use them. This is why parentheses, despite not generally considered to be an operation, are first on the order of operations. Parentheses are usually not considered an operation because they are not doing anything to input values. They aren't changing the values like if you were to add or multiply. However, by first placing parentheses on the order of operations, we can completely control the order of an expression any way we like. Parentheses explicitly tell us what comes next, no matter what other rules we set. In fact, if you use enough parentheses, you don't even need an order of operations. But would you agree that all of these parentheses are a confusing eyesore? This may be functionally complete, but it's difficult to use. We add rules to make some of the parentheses unnecessary. Notice that if we use the standard order of operations, our expression can be reduced to this. If we use a different order of operations that simply evaluates from left to right, our expression can be reduced to this. In this particular example, we can see that both cases are about equal, using only one pair of parentheses. But this isn't always the case. Look at this expression in which our standard order is superior. Here is an expression where it's easier to evaluate from left to right. Basically, the rules of our order of operations will determine which parentheses we can safely omit, or how we can manipulate the expression. We want to choose the order of operations that proves the most useful by, on average, removing the most unnecessary parentheses. Obviously, this could vary depending on application, but I want to provide some reasons for why the conventional order of operations was established. Let's take a quick detour to explain the concept of precision. Let's say I want to describe this value on the number line. How would we do this? Well, we can see it's between 100 and 200, so we know the hundreds digit is 1. We can now see that the number's between 120 and 130, so we know the tens digit is 2. Each time we write the next digit, we are getting a more and more precise representation of this value. This is what makes real numbers so powerfully expressive. By this method, we can represent any value on the number line with arbitrary precision. Think of this like taking transportation. If you need to go somewhere close by, perhaps you only need to walk over. If the distance is long enough, you may need to take a plane. However, the plane won't take you exactly to your destination. Once you are within a smaller range of your target destination, you can switch to a car. And once you're within a smaller range, you walk the rest of the way. Now let's talk about how this relates back to the order of operations. Exponents come first. They are like taking a plane. As you can see here, assuming we are using whole numbers, there are massive gaps between consecutive exponent values. If we want to describe this value here, we need to be more precise, and that requires that we use a smaller operation to get closer, multiplication. This is like taking a car. However, this still leaves large gaps. These values here cannot all be expressed, so now we walk the rest of the way by adding the exact amount needed to reach our destination. This makes our order of operations very practical, in the same way as our transportation example. The way we actually express numbers in, for example, our usual base 10 representation, is a little bit more complicated than that, but this is the general idea. But what about division and subtraction, you might ask? We treat division exactly the same way as multiplication, because dividing by a value is the same as multiplying by its reciprocal, so all divisions can be replaced with multiplication. Likewise, we treat subtraction the same as addition, because subtracting any value is the same as adding its negative. This is why in the order of operations, multiplication and division are treated as the same priority going left to right, and addition and subtraction are treated the same way. So we mentioned that exponentiation travels further than multiplication, which travels further than addition. But why is this? Here we look at levels of abstraction. Let's define a successor operation as outputting the number that comes next. If we repeat the successor operation n times, it is the same as adding n. Therefore, the addition operation is just repeated succession. If we repeat adding the same value n times, we are multiplying by n. Multiplying is just repeated addition. And finally, similarly, exponentiation is repeated multiplication. This hierarchy of operations is called hyperoperations. Succession is considered the zeroth hyperoperator, addition the first hyperoperator, multiplication the second hyperoperator, and so on. You could continue this hierarchy if you wanted to. The fourth hyperoperator is called tetration, which you may have heard of before. The higher the hyperoperation, the earlier it must appear in the order of operations. If you've never heard of dimensional analysis before, it might sound really scary and complicated, but it's not. My last video goes in depth about what dimensional analysis is and how to apply it, so here I'll just give a brief overview, but check out my previous video if you want to learn more. We know that 3x plus 2x equals 5x, which means that we can substitute any number or expression into x and the equation would be correct. But what if I told you that you could actually substitute any dimensional units and it would still hold? For example, 3 meters plus 2 meters is 5 meters. $3 plus $2 is $5. 3 apples plus 2 apples is 5 apples. Almost anything can be considered a unit. This means that we can even do arithmetic with these units. Well, sort of. We can do 3 apples plus 2 apples, but we can't do 3 apples plus 2 oranges. As the adage goes, you can't compare apples to oranges. It turns out that you can't add and subtract arbitrary units together, but you can arbitrarily multiply and divide units. Length times length represents area. Length divided by time represents speed. Mass times length divided by time is force. Dollars divided by apples can represent the price of an apple. People times time can represent work hours. Any units, no matter how different, can mathematically be multiplied or divided together to obtain a coherent quantity. Whether or not that new unit representation is useful is a different matter, but it can always be done. This explains why multiplication comes before addition. We need to first multiply each term so that the units line up, and only then can we add everything up. Take, for example, this formula for an object's position given its constant acceleration and initial speed. If we write out each value in terms of just the units, we can see that the units need to first align before we can add the lengths to arrive at an answer. If we go out of order, we will get nonsensical units. Obviously, not every expression follows this exact rule, but that's what we have parentheses for, to explicitly lay out the exceptions when they occur. But for a vast number of applications, this is the most practical, that will result in the largest reduction in unnecessary parentheses. You may remember learning in school that addition and multiplication are associative and commutative. Let's quickly review what that means. Commutative and associative are properties that describe operations. Commutative essentially means that you can rearrange the order of the terms and the value won't change. In particular, that this statement is always true. Associative essentially means that you can place the parentheses anywhere and the value won't change. In particular, that this statement is always true. We also know that multiplication distributes over addition, meaning this statement is always true. Why did I bring up these properties? Take a look at the following expression. We can apply our properties to simplify this expression further, like this. These arithmetic properties are at the core of what makes so much of math easy to compute and work with. These properties are so fundamental that many people are constantly applying them without realizing it. Now let's assume we are using a modified order of operations, where we evaluate only from left to right by default. Notice that applying any of our properties is significantly more convoluted and less intuitive. This is another reason why our standard order of operations is so nice. It makes expressions easier to manipulate according to their algebraic properties. If you're not convinced that these expressions are or aren't equivalent, then sit back and enjoy these next few animations that demonstrate this. Thank you. Saying that polynomials are ubiquitous in math is almost an understatement. Most functions that generally behave regularly can be approximated by polynomials, which makes them exceptionally useful in many engineering applications. Even in combinatorics and number theory, fields that some may not expect to see many polynomials, they are used in many very versatile ways. The space of polynomials basically encodes the essence of addition and multiplication, and they are very well understood. Polynomials especially benefit from the order of operations. Notice that no parentheses are necessary. If the order of operations was changed to be from left to right, we would need parentheses in all of these places. Polynomials are far from the only application that benefits from the order of operations, but they should be familiar to many math students, and they are a mathematical use case that is prevalent across almost every field of math, making them a perfect practical example of where the order of operations helps us a lot. So why is the order of operations the way it is? Because that's the convention we selected that is the most practical and the most useful in most applications. If you want a different order of operations for a specific use case, such as going from left to right, you're welcome to choose any rules you want, as long as you make it perfectly clear to anyone else reading your work, and you're careful not to make incorrect assumptions. The important lessons here are the reasons why we chose the standard that we did. Most importantly, remember that the order of operations is not about mathematical truth, but about the ability to accurately and rigorously communicate. Despite being one of the first math concepts taught to students around the world, very few people understand why the order of operations is the way it is. As a kid, I also wondered who came up with these rules and why. By the time I was old enough to understand, I had taken these foundations for granted. Hopefully, this video has convinced you that there are some very good reasons for it, and you can walk away with an appreciation for the foundations you may have also taken for granted. The arguments I've listed here are probably not even comprehensive. If anyone has any other reasons to share, or even reasons or contexts in which alternative orders are better, please share them in the comments below. I am very passionate about explaining simple math and logical ideas that are not often explained or taught. And if you appreciate my work, you might also appreciate the sponsor of this video, Brilliant.org. Brilliant.org is a learning platform that offers a wide range of interactive lessons in math, as well as data science and computer science that cater to all levels, whether you're a beginner or an advanced student. They update their website with new content every month, so there's always something new to learn. Brilliant gives you bite-sized lessons that allow you to learn at your own pace and offers many fun and interactive puzzles, such as these that introduce probability or these that explain how GPS technology works. The best part is Brilliant is free to try for 30 days, and if you like it, you can use my link brilliant.org/julie, and the first 200 subscribers will get 20% off a premium subscription. So don't wait. Check it out and get learning. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.